Blackstone Audio presents Dream Park by Larry Niven and Stephen Barnes. This book is read by Grover Gardner. Preface. It's been almost 30 years since Dream Park was published, and we've been asked to reminisce a bit about how it all came to be. We had already written a novella, The Locusts, together at that point, but Steve had never written a novel. He showed up at Larry's Tarzana house with a stack of ideas, which Larry knocked down handily. Then he mentioned an idea about an earthquake at an amusement park, where the nature of the futuristic illusions hampers rescue attempts. Larry's eyes lit up, and we went upstairs and sketched out a story. We liked the idea of a park so much that we decided to write a book set there first and destroy it later. A murder mystery is a great spine for any kind of story, so it was decided upon for our fledgling effort. What was needed then was a mythology within which to place the game. Someone mentioned cargo cult magic, a form of sympathetic magic found in New Guinea, an attempt by the natives to explain the gap in wealth between Europeans and themselves. Obviously, they reasoned, the gods love us best and are trying to send us television sets and toasters. So the white men must be hijacking all that loot. Let's build airstrips in the jungles so that the gods will know where to set their planes down. It was such a delightfully loony conceit that we found it irresistible. Larry had already read Road Belong Cargo in college. Steve went out and researched like crazy, brought books and articles to Larry, and the writing began. A detective story wrapped in a fantasy wrapped in science fiction. Larry's collaborators have always been ambitious. As has been the case in all our collaborations, except Locusts, which was based on an original story by Larry, Steve wrote the first draft. He doesn't mind this at all. He actually enjoys writing and loves having Larry edit his text, considers it a learning experience to this day. On the other hand, that is not to imply that Larry doesn't do half the work. We rewrite each other's text until no one could really say where Larry ends and Steve begins. Along the way, Larry taught Steve to write a novel, how to meld character, plot, theme, extrapolation, and imagination. It was an education he could not have purchased at any price, and he wouldn't have missed it for gold. Dream Park, originally published in 1981, was an immediate success with readers and critics, but more interestingly, with gamers themselves. We had tried to incorporate ideas about not only fantasy role-playing games, Dungeons and Dragons was all the rage at the time, computer games, board games, and also ideas from paintball, just getting started, and wargaming on the military level. How, we wondered, might all this come together? A guy named Mark Matthew Simmons contacted us and asked us to use the name International Fantasy Gaming Society, which we had adapted as the governing body behind Dream Park's LARP activities. He wanted to do it for real. We happily agreed. Simmons and his friends began working out how all of this might come together, mounting real games with real gamers, indoors and outdoors. Steve actually attended one such game called Ancient Enemy and based on Australian mythology. It involved whitewater river rafting, cliff climbing, sword fighting, magic, and was just flat out one of the best times Steve had ever had in his life. What an incredible adventure. Larry, being the sane one of the pair, chose a more conservative route. He played a game held south of Los Angeles. In his hours of play, he never quite won, but did manage to stop the villain's nefarious plans. The IFGS flew us to their Denver convention a couple of times. At the second one, the manuscript for the sequel to Dream Park, the Barsoom Project, was auctioned, with the profits to go to charity. When the final price exceeded $1,000, Steve was completely overwhelmed and used up a good supply of tissues. Softy. A third Dream Park novel, The California Voodoo Game, was published a few years later, and then nothing for almost 20 years. Larry and Steve collaborated on other successful projects, but the odd balance of science fiction, the technology used to create the game, fantasy, the framework of the game itself, and murder mystery, the problem that triggered Dream Park's security personnel and sent Alex Griffin into the game, lay fallow for 2 decades. Until now. As we write these words, the authors are more than halfway through the new Dream Park novel, The Moon Maze Game. It is just too much fun to revisit these ideas and even to have guest appearances by some of the original characters, although this new book takes place decades after the first 3. But it is appropriate to look back at the beginning, to appreciate the first book, the one that started a series and a movement. The IFGS survives to this day, and share our memories. If you, the reader, get half as much fun from reading this as we had in writing it, you're in for a hell of a good time. Dream Park, published in about 10 languages and endless editions, was lightning in a bottle. We wouldn't have missed it for anything. And now, you don't have to either. Part 1. Chapter 1. Arrivals. The train sat rigid as a steel bar, poised in midair above its magnetic monorail track, disgorging passengers into Dallas Station. Its 15 cars had borne their passengers in quiet efficiency from New York to Dallas in just over half an hour, cradled in magnetic fields, traveling through vacuum at close to orbital velocity, deep underground. Chester had cut it close. He shifted his heavy backpack and strode back along the train, walking like a king, projecting confidence. There would be gamers aboard, and some would recognize him. Lore master Chester Henderson was conscious of his unseen audience. Chester! He stopped, dismayed. He knew that voice. There she was, a vision in leopard tights that drew stares from all but the most jaded. Her long red hair, plaited into a thick rope, dangled down her back to the top of her belt line. She wore heavy makeup that almost hid the fact that she was indeed a very lovely woman, but the leotards hid nothing. "Hello, Gina," Chester sighed with a tone somewhere south of resignation. "I should have guessed you'd be along." "I wouldn't miss it for anything. Remember last time when you saved me from the mammoth?" "Cost me 3 points for frostbite. I remember." "Don't complain, it's mean. Anyway, I was very appreciative." She coiled her arm around him and joined him in a rather strained lockstep toward the Dream Park shuttle. She had been, he remembered, very appreciative. "One of your strong points," he said, and put his arm around her. It felt disturbingly good, nestled there between warm curves. "Well, I'm glad you're with us. We may need to pass you off as a virgin or something."
"Would you really?" she giggled.
"I've always loved your imagination." Chester didn't smile. "But Gina, if you're in, you're going to have to follow orders a mite more carefully. You almost screwed me good. Stop that, I'm serious. This is extremely important to me, all right?" Gina looked up at him and her face grew almost serious.
"Anything you say, Chester."
Chester groaned to himself as they boarded the train. She had skill. She was better than most newcomers. She carried her weight and sometimes followed orders, too. But she treated it like some kind of goddamn game. Alex Griffin took his shuttle seat and settled back with eyes closed and arms folded comfortably. He had long since learned the value of catching bits of rest where he could, and could catnap during minutes most people spent fidgeting. He stretched and heard popping sounds as muscles and joints woke up. Small wonder they were still half asleep. 10 minutes earlier, he had been snoring in his apartment at the Coles Modular Community, with the alarm buzzing in his ears. The third time it went off, it would refuse...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.